everybody. It is your girl, Danyelle Speaks, and thank you for joining us for this next episode. Now, this summer is going to be unique in the sense of this is Extreme Tour Summer. Extreme Tour Summer. I know people are out there with the hot girl summer, but this is Extreme Tour Summer. So, I'm going to have my first guest of that tour, a wonderful musician. So, if you please welcome Max Karafilis. Thank you for joining. Now, this dude, he's smooth. And we just met each other 2 weeks ago. I was not prepared for what I heard. That is a good thing. But Max is an amazing guitar player. I'm going to start out with saying, do you play any other instruments besides the guitar? And what are they?
Yeah, my favorite instrument is drums, because that's where I started out originally. And then we picked up guitar when our original guitarist left. And then I kind of just picked up bass after playing guitar.
Ooh, multi-talented. Yeah. Love it. Love it. Now, he's only a third of the group. The name of the group is Beyond Chaotic. If you haven't heard these guys, you got to go check them out. They're absolutely incredible. Beyond Chaotic. So it's Max, is his sister plays bass, and his dad is on drums. Absolutely phenomenal. Girl bassist rock, just saying, favoritism. So with that being said, how old were you when you started playing music?
Jeez, I must have been like 10, or actually I think, drums might have been even earlier, but I know for a fact when the band started, my sister was 9 and I was 11, and that was the original 6-piece at a band camp, I think 2016.
Wow.
So
that makes you how old?
I'm 17 now. And we've been doing the 3-piece thing since about 2019.
And how did you wrangle your dad into this group?
Well, we were short a guitar player, so I just picked up guitar. We were short a drummer eventually, and I couldn't really just drum and guitar and sing.
I mean, that would be incredible.
I'd pay to see it. I didn't think about it.
Okay.
But dad, I don't know what it is. He's just extremely good at picking things up and learning very fast, and he just said, I'll do it for you if you need it. And
so he hadn't played drums before?
He's never played an instrument, period.
Okay.
And
that's amazing.
Yeah.
I am impressed.
So I just taught him with my basic knowledge of music and drumming, and I just, taught him my songs and a couple covers to get by live.
Right, right.
And he's just getting better and better. It's kind of awesome.
It's amazing to watch you guys on stage.
It's
absolutely phenomenal. How does it feel to play with family? Like, how does it feel to play with your dad when you're on the platform and you know you have your family around you?
It's kind of wild because I don't know how to put it. You're already so close, you know you can kind of get away with some garbage, right, on stage. Sometimes I'll just throw dad a curveball, and unlike with a friend or whatever, you have to, drive home with that guy, and then you're staying at the same house, and so I'll throw him some curveballs, and then, the ride might be a little shaky home. But
but you're gonna get there.
We'll get there, yeah.
That is great.
No, we joke a lot. We have a lot of fun. Alex is great. She has stepped up her bass game immensely the past year.
I love it.
She just originally gone from, similar to dad, playing my stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But she goes to this like music school, and the guy there, she almost says he doesn't really teach. He just says, here, learn this song, and I'll watch you learn it.
Or I'll come back in a minute.
Yeah, exactly. So he forces them to be very independent, keeps them on their toes, and he puts on a lot of live like performances for them, and kind of creates little bands as well.
Okay.
And then so she's been doing stuff from like ska to jazz to punk to
very
like metal.
Nice.
So
yeah, no, she's been doing all sorts of stuff and just stepping up her game.
I think with doing that, the way you guys are learning it, it creates more flexibility on stage.
Oh yeah,
because you're not so much into, well, this is how we rehearsed it, you cannot go outside of this, you know, do that. You have that flexibility to kind of play around on stage and make it fun.
Yeah.
So, and it comes across, like when we watch you guys, we're like, they are having a blast.
I'm glad.
How old were you when you first started writing music?
Writing, that probably wasn't till, what, maybe late 2017, mid 2018.
Okay.
Because summer of 2018, I think, is when I recorded the album. Because it was published, like, just at the end of 2019, I think. Maybe I'm mixing up my years, but I started writing pretty closely before the album release. Originally, when we were the six-piece, you know, I'd have, my mom actually would help us write, and some of the other parents would help us write, and I say us because as the six-piece, it was like one collective group.
Right.
We would all write together, and it was very chaotic, but not really in a good way.
Okay.
There was a lot of opposing views and stuff just wouldn't get done.
Okay.
Also, we barely knew how to do music.
Yeah.
So, not knowing...
So you're kind of filling it out.
Yeah,
right?
Not knowing how to grasp it and then trying to work with five other people, it was just not working out. So then eventually, when they all left, I just kind of sat down and I just kind of figured it out myself.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Cool. So... what is your writing process? Like, do you hear a word and you're like, all right, I'm just going to go with that? Do you hear a phrase? Do you hear notes? Like,
probably actually the opposite of you guys, because you specifically, I know your lyrical content is just phenomenal. I love listening to you.
Thank you.
Just go off.
Thank you.
But not for me, lyrics is probably the hardest part. Like,
Really?
Yeah, I usually start with lyrics last. The first thing that comes to mind, which is really odd, is a bass line. Bass is what I picked up last.
Okay.
So I don't know why, just the bass line, whenever I'm a very riff-oriented person, I guess, so I'll just kind of come up with some type of riff.
Yeah.
Just jam out on that, and then usually put guitar to that, and then I solo comes probably after the lyrics even.
Okay.
So I usually get my bass, then my guitar line, then I do drums, because drums is like my favorite part. I usually have the most fun with that. Then I'll sit down, draft some basic words, basic phrases, whatever feels good.
Yeah, yeah.
Then I usually write a solo, and then when it comes to actually like putting the whole thing together, then I kind of refine the lyrics.
Okay. It's all about the bass. I mean,
yeah.
the bass and the drums is what carries any song. Even if you take the drums out, if you got a solid bass, you can still rock that song.
Exactly.
So, in the fundamental of it, yeah, it makes sense, you know. And everybody's process is different. There's not a I don't think that there's a wrong way to write a song, because it's about how you feel.
Yeah.
You know, and everything just comes together and it just flows. And that's why we have been singing you guys' songs like we just be jamming it out. And it's funny because whenever you're singing somebody else's song, it's like you always remember those cool parts that you like, and then nobody knows the rest of the song.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we come back to the part that we like. So what are the songs that you do that we all jump on is Kung Fu.
Okay.
I know Kung Fu. Like, you had us on that one. How did you come up with that song? And like, what happened?
That one's so niche. Cause there's two different songs, right? There's the song that I kind of have to wrestle with for a bit, and it takes me a while.
Okay.
I know, Too Much Pressure on the album. We actually finished the current version of it in the studio, like then and there.
Mm.
But then we have songs that, as my dad describes it, I just kind of vomit out, and it's there, and that's the song.
It works.
And yeah. We, for that one specifically, we did acting before we did music.
Okay.
And a local film group reached out to us, and they were like, hey, we have this wacky slapstick kung fu movie. Would you like to do a song for us? And we don't do that. We don't usually commission work or do things like that
at all.
Right. And we were like, we'll see. And then they shot over the script anyways, and we read the first like 3 pages, and we immediately just like that had an idea.
That is great.
Yeah.
That is absolutely incredible.
It was maybe what, like 3 hours, we had the majority of the song done and just in its current state.
Yeah. We love the current state, so don't change it. Yeah. If you don't mind, don't do that. So what do you have, guys have a specific place that you record out of?
Well, we've done several places. So I rough track at home.
Okay.
Drums are difficult. We'll just kind of film that on
a
phone.
Yes.
But we did the first album at Burnt Orange, which is a place back home, an amazing live studio. And actually, he just changed locations, and it's even better.
Wow. And what's the name of the first album?
This Can't Be Good.
This Can't Be Good, okay.
And then the second album, which is to be announced.
Okay.
That one we recorded at Hollow Studios, which was a more, I guess, digital workspace.
Yeah.
Which is very different from what we were used to. However, it led to much more flexibility.
Yes.
We were able to like, all right, we don't like this. All right, let's entirely change it.
Yeah.
And then it didn't take like a whole other recording process.
Right.
Didn't have to retry.
Right.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. It calms the nerves, I guess, a little bit. Oh, speaking of nerves, do you guys get nervous when you're in the studio, or do you get nervous when you're on the stage, or neither, or?
Depends. I remember actually at the Objective, I was a little like, all right, there's a lot of people watching, and this is kind of like a professional stage.
Oh, yeah.
But after that, it was just like, I'm just gonna do my thing. And Dad was like, I can't remember what it was, but before we went on, he's like, you ready? You got this? I was like, yeah, I got this. And he said something like, just another gig. And I went, yeah, just another gig.
Absolutely.
And we just went out and did our thing. And then, yeah, that usually, on stage, I'm usually good. But in the studio, that's a whole different beast. I hate the studio. It makes me so upset because
being
able to like, I'll sing through something and the guy in the booth will just be like, can we do that like one more time? I'm like, yeah, okay. But then after like 7 or 8 times, I'm like, oh, come on, please.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like one of these takes, please, sir.
Yes.
And it is like the emotion is different.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It's really hard. Unless you're doing a live recording.
Yeah.
It's hard to get that emotion. And even if you do, it's like you have that one take and you're like, I gave it my all. And then next time you hear that, hey, can you do that one part again? It's like, dude, I just gave it.
Yeah.
I just gave you that one on the last take. Like, what are we doing here? It is, so it's hard to capture it. Like you said, on that 7th, 8th time, you're like,
yeah, it's just, it's gone.
Can you piece together something out of those 7 or 8 times to make this thing work?
The one thing for the first album, I just had to trust the guy. He would just keep like, all right, we're going to retrack that, redo that, redo that, redo that. And after a while, at one point on one of the songs, I can't remember what it was so long ago, I just got fed up. I was like, can I just come hear it? We have something. And we go in, and like, there were parts that I nailed in like almost every take, but there was one spot where it just wasn't right in every one. And he's like, yes, that one right there. And I'm like,
and you heard what he was talking about.
I was like, all right, let's go fix that. Then I'd go back out. But yeah, he would always say, I know you're giving it 100%.
Yeah.
He's like, well, this is the studio. And kind of like now, we have like this really nice audio setup. He's like, you're going to hear everything. You need to give it 110%. And I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It makes a big difference. And like, even when you're doing live, because you have the audience and because you have the group around you, the energy kind of masks
those
mistakes. So when you do make that mistake, they're all in.
Yeah.
So it's like, I didn't make a mistake. Kung Fu. Like, it don't even matter.
Yeah.
Like, we just go with it,
yeah.
Which is great. Speaking of The Objective, for you guys watching who don't know about The Objective, The Objective happens once a year. It's in Tennessee. And that is like the introduction or more in-depth outlook of what the Extreme Tour is, what the Extreme Tour does. So, for those of you who don't know, The Extreme Tour is like a musicianary tour. Basically, it's independent recording artists. And we volunteer and we're like, hey, we want to bring the party to you. Because, you know, some of you may not be able to come party with us. We're going to bring the party to you. And it, what's unique about it is that we go to places where a lot of the major recording artists, like, they'll skip over the small towns.
Yeah.
So that people in the small towns are like, man, like, they're the ones who listen to the music the most. But they don't have the opportunity to get there. Maybe sometimes the concert venue is like an hour and a half, 2 hours away. And then the ticket's like $75 to $100 a ticket.
Yeah.
And, you know, by the time you do all that and they get back home, it's they feel kind of left out, you know.
For sure.
The Extreme Tour, we get to go inside these cities, set up right in their hometown and jam out. And I'm not talking about, oh, we're just going to do it for like 1 or 2 hours. No, it's like 4 hours, 7, 8, 9 different bands. We're just coming on and off and we're just going. So the objective is like the more in-depth outlook of, all right, this is what you're getting into. So you got one more time to pull out before we get these dates. So this is your last warning. So that's what the objective is. And then you go on tour. So what is it about the Extreme Tour? Well, two questions.
Yes.
Number one, how did you guys find out about the Extreme Tour?
I want to know how they found out about us. We were so shocked. Even Ted jokes about it. So we didn't feel bad like saying this. We were like, is this like a scam email? Like,
right.
what is this, like,
right.
Bait? Like, who is this? Oh, yeah, you want to come to our thing and
right,
you,
right.
You want to tour.
How much money do we have to
yeah,
pay
I'm
for
like,
this?
What, what's,
right.
what's
going on?
But eventually, I think we got like 2 emails, and Dad actually missed the first one, saw the second one, went back, saw the first one. He goes, they've been messaging us a bit. Like, I don't know if, should we check it out? And I was like, yeah, why not? Whatever. So he responded, something, something, something. Before we know it, yeah, we're in Tennessee. And yeah, we were like, oh, wow, this is real.
Yeah.
And we're meeting all these different bands and all these different acts. And we're like, holy cow, there are some established
yes.
people here. Yeah.
Yes. So what was the final draw of, yeah, we need to be here. Like, this is what we need to be doing.
Just the fact that, like, kind of like you said, the whole message of going to people's hometowns and like playing for them and doing a concert for them. I
yeah.
thought that was
yeah.
super sick. Cause I remember, I've been to quite a few concerts, but there were some concerts when I was younger, they were in like, say, Miami, or
mm-hmm.
they were in up by the Panhandle.
Yeah.
Which is just like, you know, I thought it was weird that they didn't go to Tampa. Or, like, because even we're on, like, the outskirts of Tampa.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, that's not even that far a drive. We're like, oh, yeah, we'll go into the city.
Right.
But if it's, like, you know, other side of the state, we're like, oh, well, that
takes you hours
it's a
to
bummer.
Get
and,
yeah.
yeah, sometimes, like, most of the time, we wouldn't even go. We're like, oh, we have to drive more than an hour. We're not doing it.
Yeah.
So it was like, oh, we'll see him some other time in life.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
It's like, it just won't happen today.
Yeah, exactly. No, just to, like, go to these people's, like, homes, basically, like, even... What, the 2 gigs ago, I think, we set up, like, right by someone's house.
Yes.
yeah. Just to, like, yeah, be that close and intimate
don't get
with people.
Yeah, it doesn't get much up close and personal
yeah.
than that.
Like, no,
we here, just walk outside.
It's amazing. And I also love the whole idea that Jerry goes over about how, like, we're the guys on stage, and then you hop off, and then you're in the audience with the guys.
Yes.
Just watching the next act, and they're like, wait a minute, weren't you on stage or something? It's like, yeah,
exactly.
Now I'm watching these guys.
Exactly.
And vice versa, like,
yeah.
Say you're going up later, and you're hanging out in the audience, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh yeah, watch this, and then you just hop up on stage, they're like, okay, I didn't know you could do that.
Right,
yeah,
the camaraderie.
Yeah, exactly.
It's amazing.
And also,
it's amazing.
I feel like brings you closer with a lot of these people
yeah.
than you would, you know,
yeah.
doing a normal show.
Absolutely, because we're right there.
Yeah.
We're right there. So for you guys who have not heard this guy before, first of all, you're missing out. I'm going to say it again. But what we're going to do is we're going to take a quick break and then come back. But before we do, let people know how they can find your music.
You can find us on Spotify. We just put out a release, a single, Saturday night. And then we have more to come. And we're hoping to drop an album later this year. So, yeah.
Spotify. Beyond Chaotic. beyond chaotic. So we'll take a quick break, and then when we come back, Max is going to sing us one of his amazing songs that he has written because he's an amazing person. All right, we'll be right back.
In the night, but it hides in the light of day. I bought it, but now I'm broke, got nothing else lost, but I have to pay. I need it. It's like an itch you can't scratch or a scab you can't peel away. I feed it until it grows and consumes me. Get stuck and it's here to stay.
Get it stuck in my head, I don't want it. I get it stuck in my head, I don't need it. I get it stuck in my head, I can't believe it. I got it stuck in my head, I don't need it. I got it stuck in my head, I don't want it. Got it stuck in my head, I don't need it. I got it stuck in my head, I can't believe it. I got it stuck in my head, I don't need it.
I should've known better. I can't see, I can't feel it. The memory's just a stain. I had it, but now it's all still gone. I can't feel, but I sense the pain. And when I met her, I knew it singing, it burning. I probably not survive. I blew it. I'm left going naked, just lucky to be alive. I got it stuck in my head, I don't want it. Got it stuck in my head, I don't need it. I got it stuck in my head, I can't believe it. I got it stuck in my head, I don't need it. I got it stuck in my head, I don't want it. Got it stuck in my head, I don't need it. I got it stuck in my head, I can't believe it. I got it stuck in my head, I don't need it.
I got it stuck in my head, I got it stuck in my head, I got it stuck in my head.